العلم بك حتى صارت خاشعة وعلى جوارح سعت إلى فكيف احتمالي لبلاء الآخرة وجليل وقوع المكاره فيها وهو بلاء تطول مدته ويدوم مقامه ولا يخفف عن أهله لأنه لا يكون إلا عن غضبك وانتقامك وسخطك وهذا ما لا تقوم له السماوات والأرض يا سيدي فكيف بي وأنا عبدك الضعيف ضج وأبكي لأليم العذاب وشدته أم لطول البلاء ومدته فلئن صيرتني للعقوبات مع أعدائك وجمعت بيني وبين أهلي بلائك وفرقت بيني وبين أحبائك وأوليائك فهبني يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي وربي صبرت على عذابك فكيف أصبر على فراقك وهبني صبرت على حر نارك فكيف أصبر عن النظر إلى كرامتك أم كيف أسكن في النار ورجائي عفوك فبعزتك يا سيدي ومولاي أقسم صادقا لئن تركتني ناطقا لأضجن إليك بين أهلها ضجيج الآملين ولا أصرخن إليك صراخ المستصرخين ولا أبكين عليك بكاء الفاقدين ولا أنادينك أين كنت يا ولي المؤمنين يا غاية آمال العارفين يا غياث المستغيثين
يا غياث المستغيثين يا غياث المستغيثين
يا حبيب قلوب الصادقين ويا إله العالمين أفتراك سبحانك يا إلهي وبحمدك تسمع فيها صوت عبد مسلم تجن فيها بمخالفته وذاق طعم عذابها بمعصيته وحبس بين أطباقها بجرمه وجريرته وهو يضج إليك ضجيج مؤمل لرحمتك ويناديك بلسان أهل توحيدك ويتوسل إليك في ربوبيتك يا مولاي فكيف يبقى في العذاب وهو يرجو ما سلف من حلمك أم كيف تؤلمه النار وهو يأمل فضلك ورحمتك أم كيف يحرقه لهيبها وأنت تسمع صوته وترى مكانه أم كيف يشتمل عليه زفيرها وأنت تعلم ضعفا أم كيف يتقلقل بين أطباقها وأنت تعلم صدقه أم كيف تزجره زبانيتها وهو يناديك يا ربا أم كيف يرجو فضلك في عتقه منها فتتركه فيها؟ هيهات، ما ذلك الظن بك، ولا المعروف من فضلك، ولا مشبه لما عاملت به الموحدين من برك وإحسانك. فباليقين يقطع لولا ما حكمت به من تعذيب جاحديك، وقضيت به من إخلاد معانديك، لجعلت النار كلها بردا وسلاما، وما كان لأحد فيها مقرا ولا مقاما. لكنك تقدست أسماؤك، أقسمت أن تملأها من الكافرين، من الجنة والناس أجمعين، وأن تخلد فيها المعاندين، وأن تجلى ثناؤك قلت مبتدئا، وتطولت بالإنعام متكرما. أفمن كان مؤمنا كمن كان فاسقا لا يستوون. إلهي وسيدي، فأسألك بالقدرة التي قدرتها، وبالقضية التي حتمتها وحكمتها، وغلبت من عليه أجريتها، أن تهب لي في هذه الليلة وفي هذه الساعة كل جرم أجرمته، وكل ذنب أذنبته، وكل قبيح أسررته، وكل جهل عملته، كتمته أو أعلنته، أخفيته أو أظهرته، وكل سيئة أمرت بإثباتها الكرام الكاتبين الذين وكلتهم بحفظ ما يكون مني، وجعلتهم شهودا علي مع جوارحي، وكنت أنت الرقيب علي من ورائهم، والشاهد لما خفي عنهم، وبرحمتك أخفيته، وبفضلك سترته، وأن توفر حظي من كل خير تنزله، أو إحسان تفضله، أو بر تنشره، أو رزق تبسطه، أو ذنب تغفره، أو خطأ تستره. يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي ومالك رقي، يا من بيده ناصيتي، يا عليما بضري ومسكنتي، يا خبيرا بفقري وفاقتي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب. أسألك بحقك وقدسك وأعظم صفاتك وأسمائك، أن تجعل أوقاتي من الليل والنهار بذكرك معمورا، وبخدمتك موصولا، وأعمالي عندك مقبولا، حتى تكون أعمالي وأورادي كلها وردا واحدا، وحالي في خدمتك سرمدا. يا سيدي، يا من عليه، يا من عليه معولي، يا من إليه شكوت أحوالي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا رب،
يا ربي يا رب. قوي على خدمتك جوارحي، واشدد على العزيمة جوانحي، وهب لي الجد في خشيتك، والدوام في الاتصال بخدمتك، حتى حتى أسرع إليك في ميادين السابقين، وأسرع إليك في البارزين، واشتاق إلى قربك في المشتاقين، وأدنو منك ندوى المخلصين، وأخافك مخافة الموقنين، واجتمع في جوارك مع المؤمنين. اللهم ومن أرادني بسوء فأرده، ومن كادني فكد، واجعلني من أحسن عبيدك نصيبا عندك، وأقربهم منزلة منك، وأخصهم زلفة لديك، فإنه لا ينال ذلك إلا بفضلك. وجد لي بجودك، واعطف علي بمجدك، واحفظني برحمتك، واجعل لساني بذكرك لهجا، وقلبي بحبك متيما، ومن علي بحسن إجابتك، وأقلني عثرتي، واغفر زلتي، فإنك قضيت على عبادك بعبادتك، وأمرتهم بدعائك، وضمنت لهم الإجابة، فإليك يا ربي نصبت وجهي، وإليك يا ربي مددت يدي، فبعزتك استجب لي دعائي، وبلغني مناي، ولا تقطع من فضلك رجائي، واكفني شر الجن والإنس من أعدائي. يا سريع الرضا، يا سريع الرضا، everybody، يا سريع الرضا، اغفر لمن لا يملك إلا الدعاء، فإنك فعال لما تشاء. يا من اسمه دواء، وذكره شفاء، وطاعته غنى، ارحم من رأس ماله الرجاء، وسلاحه البكاء. يا سابغ النعم، يا دافع النقام، يا نور المستوحشين في الظلام، يا عالم لا يعلم، صل على محمد وآل محمد، وافعل بي ما أنت أهله، وصلى الله على رسوله والأئمة الميامين من آله، وسلم تسليما كثيرا. صلوات الله.
سيدي مولاي أبا عبد الله، صوت عن نفسي ونيابة عن والدي ووالدي والدي وكل من كل الزهر كربة الله تعالى. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله، السلام عليك يا وارث نوح نبي الله، السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله، السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله، السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله، السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله، السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين علي ولي الله، السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى، السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى، السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء، السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى، السلام عليك يا أثار الله وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور، أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة، وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر، وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين، فلعن الله أمة قتلتك، ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك، ولعن الله أمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا. وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبإيابكم موقن بشرائع ديني وخواتيم عملي وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى أخيك وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين الذين بذلوا مهجهم دون الحسين. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى أخيك أبي الفضل العباس وعلى أختك الحوراء زينب. اللهم وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي الباقر وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي الجواد وعلي بن محمد الهادي والحسن بن علي العسكري والخلف الهادي المهدي. حججك على عبادك وأمنائك في بلادك صلاة كبيرة دائمة تامة. اللهم هؤلاء أئمتي بهم أتولى ومن أعدائهم أتبرأ. اللهم ارزقني في الدنيا زيارتهم وفي الآخرة شفاعتهم. اللهم صل على ولي أمرك القائم المؤمل والعدل المنتظر وحفه بملائكتك المقربين وأيده بروح القدس يا رب العالمين. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصل اللهم على خير خلقك محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على أشرف الخلق والأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, inshallah we are going to continue talking about the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on Quran. Mostly it is on Quran. And these stories of the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not for entertainment. It is for reflection, comprehension, and to inshallah, benefit from them and take some lessons. Tonight, inshallah, we're going to talk about Nabi Nuh alayhi salam, Prophet Noah and Quran. So we're going to talk about some information about the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, his dialogue, conversation with his people. He persistently used various means and methods for preaching, for convincing his people, but his people continued to disbelieve. Remarkable patience. Like, imagine he was preaching for 950 years. And imagine how many years he lived before and after that. His final report to Allah prior to the flood, it is in Surah Nuh. He said, وَرَبِّ لَا تَذَرْ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ دَيَّارًا إِنَّكَ إِن تَذَرْهُمْ يُضِلُّ عِبَادَكَ وَلَا يَلِدُوا إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَّارًا رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ والمؤمنات ومن دخل وللمؤمنين ولمن دخل بيتي مؤمنا. Okay, and inshallah we're going to talk about it and why he said this. ربي لا تذر على الأرض من الكافرين ديارا. Oh my Lord, do not leave any disbeliever on the earth. Which means that he is telling Allah, that's it. There is no hope for them to convert to Islam or to be believers. The dawn of a new generation. So let's talk about the first part, some information about Prophet Noah alayhi salam. His story was mentioned in 29 surahs in Quran. Out of 114, 29 surahs talked about his story, like from different angles, some of them short, some of them with details. Surah Hud detailed Noah's tale more than any other surah in Quran, even though there is a surah called Surah Nuh, but didn't talk about him as well as Surah Hud in Quran. His name was mentioned 43 times in Quran. Unique greeting. He is the only one who got this kind of greeting. Salamun ala Nuhin fil alameen. Alright. Peace be upon Nuh among the whole world. Okay, like the previous one and the later ones. He had three sons, Sam, Ham, Yafet. And Canaan, he died in the flood. And he was a disbeliever. And as Arab, all of us, and also the Jews, all of them belong to the same father, Sam. So when they say anti-Semitic, all right, we Arab, we are not anti-Semitic, because we are going to be anti-Semitic to ourselves. We are Semitic too. So we are cousins. All right, more information. His name was, the real name of Prophet Nuh in some narrations by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam or other Imams, Imam Abu Abdullah Hussein or Imam Sadiq, his name was Abdul A'la, Abdul Ghaffar, Abdul Malik. Okay, the king's servant or the servant of the highest one. Something like that. It is, all these are names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means that he is the servant of God. He was named Nuh. Nuh in Arabic, it means the one who is crying. So he cried for 500 years in some narrations. So that's why he was called Nuh. He lived in some narrations for 1,490 years. And in some narrations, maybe 2,500 years, but we don't know exactly. So 950 years he spent with his people preaching. How many years he lived before and after, we don't know. These are some narrations. He called his people to Allah for 950 years. He is the only prophet, this is something unique about him, who called his people for 950 years. No other prophet or messenger preached or called his people for this long time. Who lived this long life. Whose son, wife, and people did not believe in him. His son, wife, and people. We have a similar story about Prophet Lut. His wife didn't believe in him and his people. But his son too, it is only him. He is the one who built the ship or the ark. And also he was called like the second father. Like if we call Adam the first father, so Nuh is the second one. His story is distinctive and worthy of contemplation and study. And that's what we are doing. Maybe we are going to take two nights. Inshallah, this night and maybe next one. I'm going to talk about some of the verses of Quran in Surah Hud. Okay, I hope you can see it clearly. So this ayah, we have two ayahs, 25, 26, and we have more, and we are going to have some comments on each ayah. وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. We send Noah to his people, okay? So always you see that the prophets were sent to their people. He is one of them. And always he is going to talk to them, oh my people, okay? One of the Mufassirin said, why they will say, ya qawmi, oh my people. Like when I say, oh my brothers, sisters, my beloved ones. Because you are very close, okay? So this kind or this term, my people, is going to open their heart. Like, I want to, like, you know, help you. I am to you a clear warner that you shall worship none but God. I fear for you the anger of a painful day. Now, why he didn't tell them to believe in God? He asked them to worship God, okay? أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He didn't tell them, believe in him, day of judgment, believe in me. Okay, he said, worship none but God. Worshipping entails completely obeying Allah in every aspect of one's life. Like we cannot imagine a believer unobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is praying and fasting, but at the same time, he is cheating, or he is betraying his friend. Or, for example, he is going to follow other non-Islamic rules. Like, for example, someone says, I believe in God, I am a religious person, I committed to Islam and its laws. But when it comes to inheritance, you say, no, I would like to go with the, like, you know, this system or other system. Or what we see these days is very common. When we have a divorce between a husband and a wife, and mashallah, both of them, they are religious, committed to Islam, but then, and this is a problem that we have, is with lack of education. So the wife will say, I want to go to the court, American court, and then I'm going to sue you and I want to take full custody of my kids. This is very common. How come you call yourself, you are an obedient, you are a believer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet you disobey Allah or God in certain aspects in your life? So this is the meaning of worshiping, dear brothers and sisters. If you think that you pray, you fast, you go to Hajj, you do this and that, but in other, like, you know, aspects in your life, you do not follow God, you are not a true believer. So this is the meaning of ibadah. Any questions, any comments, any thoughts? Yeah. Do you have? Yes, go ahead. No, he cannot prevent them from seeing, you know, the other spouse when they got divorced. What I am saying, we need to stick with our laws. What our laws, Islamic laws saying, okay? We have certain rules that kids supposed to go, you know, with their father. And he's going to get the custody, full custody. If they are going to, like, you know, finish 2 years, like they are 2 years and over, and according to some ulama, other ulama, they will say 7 years, okay? Or they can reach an agreement until they will, like, you know, 7 years or 2 years, and until they are going to be to reach the age of puberty, then they can decide if I want to stay living with my father or go with my mother. This is a.
Can she go and sue him in the court of law?
Okay, this is another question. We will try to talk to them, convince them to stick with the Islamic laws. Okay? This is not our subject, but okay, I'm going to answer this question. Yes. Yeah. That's fine. But if he prevented her from seeing their kids, she has the right to see them, okay? And then, if she tried to convince him, she sent him, like, you know, the sheikh, the imam, the other people, talked with his family and some, like, highly respected committee of the, like, you know, or group of the committee. They talked to him. He refused that. If there is no other way to see her kids, only by suing him, yes, she can do that. If it was the only way. So we are talking about his dialogue with his people. Look at this. Look how he started with them and what was the response. This is very important to learn how to talk. These days, especially with what is going on in Gaza, you can see a lot of debates or dialogues, right? Who is going to show the truth and who is going to defend the truth? We have seen some courageous people, men and women, they express their opinion openly. They don't care about, you know, their reaction or the consequences. Some of them, they relying on evidence or proofs. Some of them, they just, you know, fabricate things or relying on some lies and so on and so forth. Let's learn from what Nuh alayhi salam dealt with his people. فقال الملأ الذين كفروا من قومه ما نراك إلا بشرا مثلنا. The, you know, the respected or the elite of his people who disbelieved among, like, you know, his people, they said, we see in you nothing but a man like us. And this is the first, it is the common logic, okay, that disbelievers employ or use over and over, with not just with Nuh, almost with every prophet. You are a human like us. You are a man like us. Why should we listen to you? You said that you have a connection with God, so you are not supposed to be a human. You're supposed to be an angel. So this is the first thing always they are talking about. And we see that only the worst among us have followed you, those of immature judgment. Now they talked about his followers. They are poor. They are maybe the lowest class in our community. Okay? They are not the elites. They are not the leaders. They are not the rich ones. Okay? They are not the celebrities and so on and so forth. Like the most important people in our society. Who are they? None of them followed you. Those are like naive people. They are not well educated, followed you. Slaves who followed you. That's happened with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Slaves, poor people, and so on and so forth. So the same logic, the same accusation has been used over and over with prophets. And then what else? So this is the meaning of هُمْ أَرَاذِلُنَا بَادِيَ الرَّأِي, which means they cannot make a good judgment. They are naive, simple people. وَمَا نَرَى لَكُمْ عَلَيْنَا مِنْ فَضْلٍ بَلْ نَظُنُّكُمْ كَاذِبِينَ. And we see that you have no advantage over us. You have no superiority over us. Why should we? Are you richer than us? Do you have power more or like, what do you have? Why should we follow you? And we see people follow who? Those who have power, those who have wealth, and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, it is in every generation. So this is the logic. Talked about him, you are a human. Your followers, they are naive, simple people, slaves, poor, and so on and so forth. And who are you guys? A group of people who believed in God, and you are not superior to us. Look at the answer of Nuh alayhi salam. Qala ya qawmi, again, he didn't tell them, like, you know, go to hell. I don't care about what you are saying. Again, with love, with compassion, he said, ya qawmi, oh my people, you are still my people, I care for you. O my people, have you considered if I stand on a clear evidence from my Lord, and he has given me a mercy from himself, but you were blind to it? Can we compel you to accept it, even though you dislike it? Now, look at this discussion right here. What is your proof? I have a proof from God. I am the messenger of God. Do you have a proof not to believe in me and in God? Show me your proof. They didn't show him anything. And this is the problem. When sometimes we have dialogues, we have debates, we have discussions, some people, they just rely on lies or they are showing their ignorance. So they lacked both evidence and argument. They don't have this kind of ability to continue argue with him or to provide any evidence. They have simply blocked their minds. This is so dangerous. Someone who closed the door and he lost the key. Can he open the door? How many times you forgot your keys inside your car? I know some, they forgot it maybe twice or three times. So those people, they just block their minds, okay? They are not willing to listen. One of my friends in Minnesota, he was telling me one of his co-workers, he used to like just listen to Fox News. And then when he confronted him with some facts, the other person, he couldn't argue with him. He said, you know what? I don't want to change my mind. I just want to be in this comfort zone. I believed in this. I don't want to change my mind. Is this right? No. If you believe in the truth, you will be open to any discussion, that I'm willing to accept any question or challenge, because our goal is to seek the truth. Those people, they are not. People of Noah, they didn't want to follow the truth. So that's why they don't have any evidence. وَيَا قَوْمِ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مَالًا. O my people, I ask of you no money. I don't want you to pay me. My reward lies only with Allah. And I'm not about to dismiss those who disbelieve. I'm not going to disregard my followers. Those are Allah's believers or servants. I'm not going to kick them out. The same logic Quraysh used with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, those dirty ones, those slaves, kick them out. Give us chance to sit and talk with you. Okay, kick them out and we will believe in you. Prophet didn't accept that offer too. No, I'm not going to do this. What did he say? وَلَكِنِّي أَرَاكُمْ قَوْمًا تَجْهَلُونَ. And I see that you are ignorant people. Again, did they offer any proof, any evidence? No, they didn't. And of course, believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in something or to do something, must not be only with like full contentment, like you are going to be convinced 100%. Let's say a person, by force, he is praying, or because he is living in this community and everyone is watching him, like, you know, they were in the camp, they were in prison, they were like in a small city, all right, if he doesn't come to the mosque, oh, where are you? So he tried to, like, you know, just follow the norm. But is he going to continue praying? No. A young girl, she is wearing hijab. Why? Because everyone around her is wearing hijab. So some of them, when they came to the US, they just took it off, because they weren't convinced about wearing hijab. Same thing. We have seen some people who converted to Islam, but then when they got divorced, they went back to the previous religion or situation. But we have seen other people, regardless of different circumstances. I have seen that lady, a convert. She lived in Iran for 30 years. And you know the propaganda about wives who went to Iran. There's a movie about one of them. She lived in Iran for 30 years, yet she didn't take off her hijab. She came back. She is still wearing hijab, and she is still one of the strong believers. So believe, you need to convince someone. You cannot force him to do things. وَيَا قَوْمِي, another argument, مَنْ يَنْصُرُونِي مِنَ اللَّهِ إِنْ طَرَدْتُهُمْ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. O my people, who will support me against God if I dismiss them, my followers, the believers of God? Will you not give a thought? So I'm dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I will kick them out, Allah is going to punish me. I'm not allowed to do this. I do not say to you that I possess the treasure of God, nor do I know the future, nor do I say that I am an angel. You see, he is very frank with them. And when you want people to follow, you need to be frank with them. People followed those who have power. During the time of Saddam, because Saddam has power, you can see a lot of people followed him. But the reality of Saddam, you see it when he was in that hole and he surrendered to the Americans without even shooting one bullet. How coward he was. People didn't follow him, didn't support him because he lost his power. Who sold him? Who told the American army about his place? His followers. They got paid for that. So people are following the person who has power or has wealth or he is in a position. But he, in reality, as a person, he's not good. So the prophet here, he's not telling them, I am the most powerful. You need to follow me because I know. I have wealth. I know the ghaib. I'm like an angel. No. He was frank with them. So he wanted them to follow him because he is the follower. He wants to convince them. You see, this is a logic, a logical conversation with them. He wanted to enter their minds and hearts, not to make them follow him by having wealth and power and so on and so forth. And he refused to do so, and he told them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power, and then I am not going to kick my followers or the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah knows better than you about them. They are good or bad. If I will do this, if I will kick them out, I would be one of the wrongdoers. قالوا يا نوح قد جادلتنا فأكثرت جدالنا فأتنا بما تعدنا إن كنت من الصادقين. So you see, they have no logic. They cannot continue talking to him. They said, oh Noah, you have argued with us and argued a great deal. Now bring upon us what you threaten us with. Punishment from God? Bring it down. If you are truthful, you see, when you are talking to someone who has no argument, who has no evidence, no proof, he's going either to accuse you, oh, you are like a wicked, you are a liar, you are this and that. Or like, you know, people of Noah at that time, oh, bring the punishment of God. You threatened us with it? Bring it. They just want to end this kind of discussion. Or I remember when we were having some discussions with the communists, they have no proof for what they are saying. And they say, oh, you are backwards. You are this and that. Because they have no evidence. So they have simply blocked their minds and they don't want to continue. So about adab, about punishment, قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَأْتِيكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهُ إِنْ شَاءَ وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. He said, it is God who will bring it down, the punishment, the chastisement. Bring it upon you. If he wills, it is in Allah's hands. And you will not be able to escape. My advice will not benefit you, much as I may want to advise you. Why? Because you already blocked your minds. You are not allowing the truth to, encompass your heart. If God desires to confound you, what does it mean, this word? أَن يُغْوِيَكُمْ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desired to make you deviants, if he wanted you to be disbelievers, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to leave you alone, is going to make you follow what you decided to follow. If you wanted to be misguided, Allah will not, try to force you to change your mind. No. And he will not give you maybe another chance. That's it. Because many, many chances. You got many, many chances. And that's it. So يغويكم means يترككم لشأنكم. He will leave you to your choices. You chose to be disbelievers. That's it. Huwa Rabbukum. Again, he reminds them. He is your Lord. Wa ilayhi turja'un. And to him you will be returned. Any questions, any comments? All right. Inshallah. Continue next week talking about other, inshallah, subjects in this story. And we are going to talk about, inshallah, the means or what Nuh alayhi salam used, what ways that he used to convince his people. And also we are going to talk about his son, why he became a disbeliever. Do you have a question? Asking God to bring the
chastisement. So meaning that this sabr or the patience of Nuh is completely accurate. Right? So I believe as a Muslim you should follow Rasulullah. So be patient. So what do you think about
it? Okay. Inshallah, when we talk about the ways and different means that he used to convince his people, we are going to talk about his patience. And that patience continued for maybe more than 950 years just with his old people, okay? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused them to die, right? He drowned them. How many? We don't know. Hundreds? Thousands? We don't know. But of course, over like hundreds of years. Does he have patience? Yes. No, does he have patience? Yes. Did he reach the level he just wanted to get rid of them? No. Did he hate them? No. Did he wanted the adab, the chastisement, to come down to them? No. He reported to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that my job here is done. I cannot do anything else. I reached to the last point, end. The dua, I read it, Rabbi la tadhar ala al-ardi min al-kafirina dayyara. Yes. You think he is hopeless? Okay, that's good. There is, when you say he is hopeless, based on what? Based because, you know, he has no more patience? Or he sees exactly the results of his work. It is not going to work at all. Like maybe for the last 500 years, for the last maybe 600 years, no one believed it in him. And the generation of their generation, they became deviants. So that's it, done. I have no control over them. They are not going to listen to me anymore. That's it. So he just reported to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and based off his love to Allah and mankind, so he wanted generation or people to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, from the beginning, he told them, if you are not going to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is going to
punish you.
From the beginning, the same punishment or similar punishment came to people of Salih alayhi salam, or Hud, or other prophets, except of course for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even punishments for Bani Israel when they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many, many cases. One of them by killing, like, you know, those who worship the calf. It was a severe punishment. It is also killing. So what we are saying, it is a long story with the prophets. Is he a sincere prophet? Yes. Did he give up? No, he didn't give up. But he just, you know, told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala what he has seen. And he is telling Allah, you know, we are not going to have any believers from these generations. That's it, done. But didn't mean that he has no energy. He has no, like, you know, I don't want to continue this job. No. But he just, like you, when you go, you can say, okay, if you are a doctor, so you will say, the patient is going to die. That's it. Like, whatever you know about science and, you know, your experience telling you that, he's going to die. Inshallah, we are going to shed more light on your work. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.